For all those who are able, please stand for the call to worship. Rise up.
We come to worship you, O God. We are ready to be filled with your presence.
Rise up.
All honor and glory and blessing are yours, O God, forever and ever.
Rise up.
We lift our hands and praise your name. You are the good shepherd who cares for the flock. We hear your voice and we follow you.
Rise up.
We answer your call to be present in your communities, to go beyond these walls, praising your name, sharing your mercy, and witnessing to the transforming power of your love. Rise up.
Thank you. Please join me in our opening prayer. Loving God, we come before you with great thanks and praise. We are reminded every day of your loving presence and your promise to be with us in the hardest of times. We come together today with preoccupations and concerns. Help us set those aside for the moment and be present with you, God, and one another in this space. Help us draw close to you and feel the Holy Spirit moving among us during this time of worship. Amen. O Christ, our familiar stranger, you meet us on our way and will not let us go. As we wrestle with your truth, give us your unfathomable blessing so that washed in love, we may lose our fears and draw closer to you. Amen. Peace and the love of God be with you.
And also with you.
Please welcome one another. Go ahead. Let the children come. Good morning.
Good
morning. Good. Everybody join in with her again. Let's do this again. Good morning. You know what? I remember your grandpa when he was a little boy. Not that little, I know. And your Aunt Lisa when she was a little girl. Well, good morning. Well, everybody just look back at the pulpit and let's hear what we're going to hear from God's Word. Watch back there.
Today's scripture reading is from Luke chapter 1, verse 68. Praise be to the Lord because he has come and has redeemed his people.
Well, did you hear that word redeemed? Do you know what it means? Does anybody got an idea? No, it's a big word, isn't it? A different word. It's when you redeem something. Let's say I go into a store and I see a candy bar. Now, not saying that I would do this since I'm a diabetic, but let's hypothetically say I would buy that candy bar. Now, it would be my responsibility to, don't you think if I saw an almond joy in a store, wouldn't it be my responsibility to buy an almond joy? Yes, it would be, wouldn't it? Yes. And so what do I do when I buy that almond joy? Big kids? What? Well, I know, but I got to buy it. What do I do when I buy it? How do I buy it? What do I do? Yeah. I give the money to the people that have the candy bar in their store. Right. And you know what I've done? I have saved that candy bar from the store. I've redeemed it. See? When you buy a candy bar, you are saving that candy bar from the store. It doesn't have to sit in that store and get moldy and all that kind of stuff. So then you take it home and you eat it. Or maybe you eat it in the car. Or maybe you eat it on the way to the car. But you've redeemed it. In other words, redeemed is when someone has paid a price to get something else. You redeem it. What we as Christians understand is that Jesus paid the price to redeem us. That's when we talk about redemption. Jesus died on a cross, was resurrected from dead, and is alive again. And what he did was he redeemed us from the cost that we might have to pay for the things that go wrong in the world. Jesus took all that on himself. So he redeemed us. Just like when I buy a candy bar, I redeem it by giving him a buck or two. Depends on the kind of candy bar it is, you know, and I like the very nice ones. But when you give that dollar to them, you're redeeming them for taking it away with you. Christ gave his life that we might have life and that we might find joy and happiness in life. He died on the cross for us, and so he redeemed us. That's what that word means. Simple, isn't it? But not really simple, because Jesus had to pay the price. He paid the price for you and for me and for mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, aunts and uncles and everybody. But because he did, we can live and enjoy life and be happy. And we need to thank God for that, right? Don't we need to thank God so we can be, for us being able to be happy? I think you agree, don't you? Would you like to pray with me?
Yes.
Thank you. Let's bow our heads. Oh God, we thank you for our kids, and we thank you for their love for you and for the church. We thank you for the mothers and fathers who bring them up in the church and bless them with the knowledge of your love and your son Jesus. And we pray, God, that we might do a great job for your children here, and that they too will grow up and teach their children as well. Watch over these, we pray, in the name of Jesus our Savior. Amen. Thank you for coming up. Thank you, choir. The scripture lesson today comes from John chapter 10, beginning the 22nd verse. At that time, the feast of dedication took place at Jerusalem, and it was winter. And Jesus was walking in the temple, in the colonnade of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." And Jesus answered them, "I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." May God add his blessing to the reading and the hearing of this God's holy word. Yes, I'm going to make this real easy for you. We're going to have the balcony on that side and those folks over to the middle begin. And then we're going to jump in and have this side and that side and that balcony jump in. And then we're going to have the choir jump in. You get it? Just give me a note. I'm not going to do this to you. Ready? On this side. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice.
Rejoice.
Keep going. Keep going. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Well, that's one of the joys of that new hymnal. We have a whole bunch of choruses now that we can pull from that and use in these kinds of situations, and that's one of them. I know some of you had heard that before, but isn't that fun? Yeah. Happy for your birthday. This was something that your husband had planned for quite a while, I imagine. It took time to get them all together. So be nice to him for that. And he didn't say how old you are, so be nice to him for that. That's okay, because I'm older than both of you put together. And you know, there. And also for those of you in the house who went to Mad Camp and all those things like that, there is a Studeman in the house. Lisa married Mickey's son. I forgot your mom's name. Carolyn. Yeah, Mickey and Carolyn's son. So those of you who all went to camp or did counseling there, look him up and give him some good stories. Anybody who knew Mickey knows that there's a lot of good stories to tell. Yeah, we're glad that all of you are here, and happy that everybody's here to share it together. I hope what I have to say will strengthen you in your faith and help you to grow stronger and closer to God. We exist only by the grace of God. We exist only by the grace of God. The impact of Jesus' death and resurrection has been to amplify that truth before all the world and across all of space and all of time. And therefore, those of us who choose to respond to Jesus' resurrection call, and that call is to follow him, are the ones who become able to fully experience the truth that God's grace is sufficient. You see, Jesus as is the personification of God's grace. God's grace is the fullest expression known of unmerited love. God's grace is the fullest expression known of the mercy that there is to find, of favor in the world. So Paul the Apostle wrote to the church in Corinth, and he told them about a vision that he had in which God said to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Now that seems to be something that doesn't make sense, that God's power is made perfect in weakness. And so it was, though, in Jesus' weakest, most vulnerable moment when he was dying on a cross, that the overwhelming power of God shone through it all, through the tragedy of it all, through the terribleness of it all. And God's power prevailed. With the wonder of hindsight, now, the disciples and we have been able to look back over the course of Jesus' life, and now we all realize that the Savior shared fully in God's work. That is so true that it would be impossible to distinguish one from the other. God apart from Jesus, Jesus apart from God, because of the unity of purpose that Jesus so clearly expressed in the way he lived his life and what he did, yet in truth, he and God are one. In him and through him, we find God's grace at work, the most perfect way of seeing God's grace. And that is because Jesus told his detractors who were trying to trap him that day, he told them, "I and the Father are one." In John's gospel, then, we are told what the impact of this grace so fully expressed in Jesus means for you and means for me. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they will follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand." Drawing a comparison of Jesus' relationship to his followers, likening that of a shepherd's concern for his sheep, spoke volumes to the people in that time, because these were Bedouin shepherds. These were people who knew what it was to have sheep. And sheep were the life of many people. They used the wool, of course, and they used them for meat, and there was a whole bunch of things, but they took good care of their sheep. Well, what was Jesus saying that day? First, he said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they will follow me." Shepherding sheep is an exacting business. It requires a great amount of attention to all the needs of each and every sheep in the flock. That is because sheep are timid, easily frightened, and as a result can easily panic and do stupid things. Did I say people or did I say sheep? In his book, A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23, Philip Keller, himself a shepherd, examined the well-known Psalm, 23rd Psalm, line by line in his book, and looking at it through the eyes of a professional sheep herder. And one of the observations he made was this. He said, "In the course of time, I came to realize that nothing so quieted and reassured the sheep as to see me in the field. The presence of their master and owner and protector put them at ease as nothing else could do, and this applied day and night." Jesus, our Savior, our Master, our Shepherd, is in that same way very present with us as well. In the time Jesus spoke those words that John recorded, the only way one's voice could be heard is if the person was there personally. There was nothing else. You know, today, the way things are, of course, there are many ways that one's voice can be heard all around the world without even leaving his or her easy chair. You can Skype, you can call on the telephone, you can use the short, if you want to go way back, you can use shortwave radio. And in the future, it'll be, Scotty, beam me up. Yeah. All those kinds of things we can do right from the chair. But when Jesus was here on the earth, what Jesus was saying is that he is very present in his each person's life, each of his children's life, who has chosen to be his follower. We know his voice when he speaks to us in the nights of doubt and sorrow, which you have had in your life. You know that. I may not know what they were about, but you've had them. Nights of dark doubt and sorrow. We feel his presence when we gather around this communion table and we remember what he has done for us all. Where for some of you, your moms and dads, your grandmas and grandpas, your great-grandmas and grandpas, and the founders of this church back in the 1840s gathered around this table. Jesus himself said, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them." So, let's see, we got a couple hundred. He must be here. Must be here. Because he'll do it for two or three people. I have trouble preaching for just two or three people. I will just hand them the manuscript. It's a waste of my time. But where two or three people are gathered, Christ is with them. Therefore, Christ is among us right now. He is present with us in this place. In a spiritual sense, Christ is here. And so it is, our Lord speaks to us, and his voice is very real as we read the scripture. It's very real, his voice is, as we discuss the word of God. It's very real as we hear the preacher preach, as we pray a prayer with faith that God hears that prayer and knows who each of us happens to be. And we each know to whom it is that we belong. Jesus the Christ, our Savior. And it is his voice, and it is his resurrection call that we who have named ourselves, you know, we have named everyone in this room, I believe, the reason why you're here, why you were called to this place, is that you have named yourself Christian. That you carry is a name that identifies you. And I believe that everyone here who has heard his resurrection call then wants to and must follow. The next thing he said to his detractors that day, he said, "I give them eternal life and they will never perish." A lot of time is wasted by various Christians who are worried about the physical aspects of how God created our bodies. The true creation is not the body. Nor does it really matter how that body came to be. It's ridiculous to waste all your time trying to figure that one out. It doesn't prove or disprove God. The only point of this body is that it houses here on earth a being who was created to be eternal. And we call that the soul for lack of how else to describe it. My body is my vehicle to navigate through this world. My soul, however, is who I am. Now, my body may not be a Cadillac. Not that Cadillacs are any better than my Honda. But who I am can be a Cadillac. My soul can be rich and full. Yes, who I am is more important than what I am or what I look like or how I walk through this earth, because this is a vehicle to get Ed Bray around. And though often mistakenly credited to C.S. Lewis, the great theologian, many of you know C.S. Lewis is the one who wrote the Chronicles of Narnia, you know, though that you know, where they, you know, no one bought that. But C.S. Lewis is a great theologian, and many people have credited this statement to him, but it was a Quaker author named George MacDonald who wrote in 1892, he said, "Never tell a child you have a soul, teach him you are a soul, you have a body. You are a soul, you have a body." We are more than flesh and bone. The body may die, but the soul that has aligned himself or herself with Jesus Christ will not perish. John 3:16 makes that clear. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish but have everlasting life." And then 17, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Jesus said, he said that to his flock, he will give eternal life. At the time he said those things, the concept of soul and body was alien to Jewish thought. You see, in Jewish thought, the soul and the body are one. The body goes, the soul goes. And so if you're going to come back to life, the body and the soul have to come together. That's how they thought. Greek thought, brought into Christianity, though, conceived of the soul's existence not being fully dependent on the body's existence. So that thought has come into play, and that's what we often preach, you know, at funerals and things like that. But some Christians have a difficult time separating the two, however, because of the belief that our bodies will be physically resurrected, as was Jesus' body, at the end of time. And so there was problem, you know, people have problems, used to have problems with people being cremated when they died. They worried that God would not be able to resurrect them at the end of time, because they're supposed to come back with God. Okay. Do you really believe that the God who created could not resurrect a pile of ashes? He took a pile of dust and turned it into a man, breathed life into it, if the creation story is actually what happened, which doesn't matter whether it's actually what happened or not. Do you honestly believe God depends on how we view the creation story? That God's existence and God's credibility is based upon that? I am content to live in eternity in whatever form God deems necessary. If it's this body coming back to life again, okay. If he makes me look different than I am, okay. If he has a special body waiting for me, okay. The point is so long as the soul that's in this body gets to look upon the face of God and live, that is what matters. The next thing Jesus said, he said, "No one will snatch them out of my hand." Just as the good shepherd guards his sheep from the thief and the wolf, keeping them safe, our Lord has promised that those of us who are part of his flock cannot be separated from him. Now, the Apostle Paul penned a brilliant summation of what Jesus' statement means for the Christian person. Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, and he said this, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I, Paul, am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." Powerful statement. Ain't nothing going to come between me and my God. That's what Paul's saying. It ain't going to happen. St. John records Jesus saying to his disciples at one point, "So, you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you." You see, there's something common in these things that Jesus is saying. There's no way, shape, or form, and Paul said too, there's no way, shape, or form, or anything can come between us and God. The only thing that can come between us and God is a person we call me. Me gets in the way. That's who comes between Ed Bray and God, is that person Ed Bray knows as me. We belong to Christ, and therefore we are safe in Christ's keeping. By God's grace, we are his. Now, the impact of Jesus' resurrection from death to life has stretched across the last 2,000 years, and you don't know, I know you don't know of anything more lasting than that. Isn't that silly when people try to talk about, you know, this is a dying religion, that Christianity is in its last stages. Christianity will be going on long past our lifetimes. No matter what the church does or doesn't do or how it messes itself up one way or the other, no matter what kind of church is more popular than the other, it's not about popularity, it's not about meeting our needs or having all those things, you know, the cafeteria-style church. Not about that. Not at all. It's about being with God in the end. Just as Jesus was physically resurrected from death to live again, so too we can be spiritually now resurrected in this life, and so too we can have eternal life with God beyond the grave. That is the promise. Jesus himself made it clear that his sheep know him, they follow him, they will live eternally, and will never perish, and they cannot be stolen from him. It is therefore because of God's great love and mercy expressed in and through Jesus that we each may find our salvation. We exist only by the grace of God. We shall live eternally and only by the grace of God, and we find that grace of God fully expressed in the person of Jesus of Nazareth, who is the resurrected Savior of us all. And that, my friends, is the good news. Will you pray with me? Oh God, we live in a complicated world where everybody wants to make everything complicated, and that includes by making our special rules that we all have as religions and being our special things that we do that we are sure the only right things to do. But the truth is that, God, it's pretty simple. You sent your Son into the world to die for our sins and to be resurrected from death so that you might prove that you have the ultimate power over sin and death, and that you bless us who want to follow you. And so each one of us came to this place today because there was a reason to be here. The ultimate reason is to worship you and to praise you. Maybe there were other reasons. Some came because of a birthday. Some came because of their soul's burdens. Some came because of pain they feel in their body. Some came because they're trying to make sense out of life and wonder what it all means. Some are here because they've always done that, come to church. But we are all here, God, because we know there is something special about you and about the name of the one you sent us, Jesus. So help us to serve you well. Forgive us of our sins. Lead us forward in life. Help us to work toward a world of peace and justice and mercy. Just like your grace is the same thing, peace, justice, mercy, unmerited love flowing from you, God, freely to all people. May we learn to live that lesson and live it well. We pray for those who are not able to be with us this morning. We pray for those who are watching by television, who are not able to be here, who would love to trade places from their sick bed with anybody in a pew here, to be able to be here. We pray for all those who serve our country, We pray for our country in this time of elections and concerns about politics and world peace. All those things we place before you, God, and we ask for your blessing. Be with those whom we love. Be with those for whom we care. Be with the world which we embrace. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples that they may pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Excuse me. Amen. Pardon me. Don't worry, it's just water. God blesses us with the ability to give. Whether it's time or whether it's talents or whether it's treasure, giving is important in our faith, because when we learn that we can afford to give it away, we learn to realize what it is that's most important to keep and have in our hearts and our souls and in our lives. So when you give a gift to the work of the church, what you're doing is really giving to something that God blesses and that your giving blesses. Whether it's your time, your talent, or your treasure, all of it counts. All of it's important. May God bless you in your giving. We are grateful, God. We are grateful for all the blessings that you pour upon us. We are grateful for how you have blessed this church, the people who are in it. You have blessed us with great and wonderful things and the opportunity to serve you with our talents, with our time, and with our treasures. Bless these gifts that have been brought to this place. May the hands that prepared them be blessed. May the homes they represent feel the power of your Spirit over them. And may we know, God, that your love prevails in our lives and works with us through the gifts that we give. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. My friends, you have no choice. You have to go out that door. I'm not going to keep you here forever. Of course, you don't want that either. But when you go out that door is where what we've talked about all morning takes effect. You are the body of Christ. You are his hands and you are his feet. You are his voice. You go out into the world with those privileges. And so when you go into that world, understand, yeah, it's something you don't like going on out there. Understand it's a hurtful place. Understand it wasn't too easy for Jesus either. If you think you got it bad, think about that. So the world has never been a really perfect place. But you make it more perfect by how you live your life, by the way you treat other people, by trying to be compassionate and understanding, by not being judgmental and thinking you have the right to do God's job. Jesus said, take care of the beam in your own eye before you worry about the speck in somebody else's eye. Just a reminder. But when you walk from this place, what you do is you represent the one who said, my sheep know my voice. The one who said, my sheep care. My sheep are near me. My sheep look for me. They want me in their life. My sheep can never be taken away from me. You are his sheep. So go live your life like that, knowing that you are in the care of Jesus the Savior, and knowing that your love out in the world does make a difference, even if it's only one person's life it touches. And you will have done what God has called you to do. Go follow him and be the children of God, the disciples of Jesus Christ, and God's love will shine on you, and God's face will be revealed to you, and God will grant you peace.